let me recall, we are probing this result. Let W be a finite dimensional subspace. Of an inner product space V and let E be the orthogonal projection of V on W. Okay, then E is an idempotent linear transformation. E is an idempotent linear transformation of V onto W. So we must show that this is an onto map, such that the following hold. First condition is that W perpendicular is the null space of V, and see, remember, in order to write this we must know that E is linear. See, what we know is that the null space or range space of a linear transformation is a subspace. So in order to write this we must know that E is linear. Okay, this is one condition that E must satisfy. And more importantly, V is the orthogonal direct sum of these two subspaces. Okay. Okay. For the proof, I remember that we have done E is idempotent and E is linear. Okay. So let me just write this. Already, we have shown that E square equal to E, that is E is idempotent and E is linear. We must show that V is onto, then W perpendicular is null space of V and this. Okay, let us first dispose this off. This is straightforward. V is onto W, that is given any X in W, can I find okay, given any u in W, can I find an x in V such that Ex equals u? It is the same thing. If, so let me write like this, if x belongs to W, then what we know is that Ex equal to x. So the pre-image is x itself, so that E is onto, let me just emphasize W. See, E is a linear operator on V. So from V to V, it is not an onto map, but if you look at the subspace W, think of E as a mapping from V to W, then it is onto. Okay, that is what this means. So it is the orthogonal projection of V onto W. We must show that W perpendicular is null space of E. Okay, so let us take so we need to show this and then this. Let us take okay, let us say Y or U or Z. Okay, Z belongs to null space of V. Z belongs to null space of V implies EZ is 0 by definition. In fact, if and only if, isn't it, by definition. But Ez equal to 0 if and only if, remember that to any fixed vector z in V, E assigns the best approximation, the unique best approximation to z from W. So, and we also know that condition. What is that condition? If Ex equal to u, then x minus u is perpendicular to W. This happens if and only if x minus u is perpendicular to W. That is, I am writing it like this, z minus 0 belongs to W perpendicular. That is the same as saying z belongs to W perpendicular. And so we have proved in one single step that the null space of E is W perpendicular. Okay, this is just the definition. How is E defined? To any vector Z, it assigns the unique best approximation, and that best approximation U satisfies X minus U perpendicular to W. That's what I have used. Okay, finally this equation. We need to show that, but that's straightforward. We show that V is W direct sum W perpendicular. Let's take X in V, then X can be written as I want it to be in this plus this. So I can write Ex plus X minus Ex. Let's call this as X1 and this as X2. X1 plus X2. Then X1 belongs to range of E, but range of V is by definition W, and X2 is X minus Ex. So I want you to look at Ex2. Ex2 is E of X minus Ex, that's 0. Ex minus E square X, but E square is E. So Ex2 is 0. Just now we have shown that null space of E is W perpendicular. So X2 belongs to W perpendicular. So for one thing, we have shown that V can be written as a sum of W1, sorry, W and W perpendicular. We must show that it is a direct sum. That is, we must show that the intersection is the subspace consisting of the zero vector alone, but that's straightforward. So what we have shown is that V is contained in W direct sum W perpendicular. So I can write equality, because this is a subspace. Direct sum is also a subspace. So this is equal. I'm sorry, W equals just W plus. Okay. Finally, if let's say Z belongs to W intersection W perpendicular, then by definition the inner product of Z with itself must be 0, because Z is orthogonal to every vector in W and Z belongs to W perpendicular also, but this means Z is 0. So the intersection is singleton, and so it follows that V is the direct sum of these two subspaces. So remember that there is no restriction on V, the restriction is only on W. It must be a finite dimensional subspace. V could be an infinite dimensional inner product space. But if W is not a finite dimensional subspace, then this is not true. Okay. If time permits, I will provide an example later. Okay, so this is a finite dimensional result. Okay, corresponding to E, we have this result. The version for F, which kind of complements E, that version is similar. So let me give you that version for the record. So the following is a consequence of the previous result. Corollary. Remember the mapping F. F is I minus E. Okay. And we have seen that F is a projection of V onto of V on W perpendicular. But what follows from this theorem is that it's an idempotent linear transformation of V onto W perpendicular this time. And what is the null space of F? What do you expect the null space of F to be? What is F? F is I minus Z. Null space of F is W perpendicular. I'm sorry. Just W. Okay. Null space of F is range of I minus E. Okay, so let's null space of F is range of E. Yes, that's W. So let's quickly dispose this one. Corresponding to E, we defined an F. So let W be a finite dimensional subspace of an inner product space V. And E denote the orthogonal projection of V on W as before. Then I minus E is an idempotent linear transformation. I minus E is an idempotent linear transformation of V onto W perpendicular such that the null space of I minus E is W. So previously we had W perpendicular to be the null space of E. That is, I am looking at the null space of the orthogonal projection at any stage. So the null space of I minus E is W. The proof is almost there, so I will not write down. The fact that E is idempotent and linear implies that I minus E is linear in the first place, and I minus E, we have seen this last time, I minus E square is I minus E. So it is an idempotent linear transformation. I minus E, that is the mapping that takes X to X minus EX, we have seen last time that it is the orthogonal projection of V on W perpendicular, that was proved. We called it F, the mapping F from V to V defined by F of X equals X minus EX is the orthogonal projection of V on W perpendicular, but from what we have seen just now it must be onto also, similar to E. I minus E behaves very similar to E, but it is complementary to E. So it is an orthogonal projection of V onto W perpendicular. So this is done, and null space of I minus E equals W is straightforward, very similar to what we have done before. Okay. So I am going to leave this last part also. Okay. Before, so this is kind of the summary of the notion of best approximation, how it helps in decomposing an inner product space in terms of a finite dimensional subspace and its orthogonal complement. Okay. So what is important is the notion of best approximation. Okay. But remember that for finite dimensional subspaces the best approximation exists and it is unique. That is, I mean, these two are important for us to do all these things. Using again this notion, we will go to the concept of adjoint of a linear transformation, then the notion of unitary operators, normal operators, finally spectral, finite dimensional spectral theorem. Okay. But before that, let's look at two examples, okay, two numerical examples where I will show how, okay, where I will try to give you another clue as to what you must expect of the linear transformation E when it is the orthogonal projection. Okay. I asked you this question, what is the difference between an ordinary decomposition, direct sum decomposition, and an orthogonal direct sum decomposition. Okay. You may be able to answer by looking at this example. So this is kind of reinforcing what we have done till now. So let us look at this example, really two examples. Let us take R2. Okay. For R2 I have the following two decompositions. Let me call W1 as a subspace that is span of 1, 1. W1 is span of 1, 1. Okay, W2 is span of 1 comma minus 1, and I'll write these are row vectors. These are row vectors. Then what is the relationship between these two? Can I say W2 is W1 perpendicular? Okay. Observe that W2 is W1 perpendicular. Let's look at another pair. I'll call it Z1. Z1 is span of, I'll take the same vector as before. So Z1 is really W1. Z2, let's say, is span of the vector 1, 2. Span of the vector 1, 2. In the first instance, obviously W1 direction W perpendicular is R2. In the second case, can I say Z1 direction Z2 is R2? First, the answer must be instant. Answer is yes. Why? These are independent vectors. Together they form a basis. And this vector does not belong to the span of this. This doesn't belong to the span of this. So the intersection is singleton 0. Okay. So for the record, R2 can be written as W1 direct sum W2 perpendicular and equal to, okay, let me write like this. And R2 equals Z1 direct sum Z2. The intersection is singleton 0, and these two vectors together form a basis. So any vector can be written as a linear combination of these two. So for sum Z1 plus Z2 is R2 is clear. Z1 intersection Z2 singleton 0 is also clear, because these are independent vectors just by inspection. W1 direct sum W2, or I will write W1 perpendicular. Yes. Okay, let's find the maps E in both these cases. Okay, what is the property of the map E that we are going to use? So subspaces are given. We want to find E. What I will do is not find E. I'll just take E to be a matrix itself. Remember, there is this one-to-one correspondence between the matrix of a linear transformation and the transformation itself. I'll write down the matrix of E relative to the standard basis and see how it looks like. By the way, can you geometrically differentiate between these two direct sum decompositions? Geometric. For the first one, it's 1 comma 1. You can think of the line y equals x. Okay, that's the line which makes 45 degrees with the positive x axis. The line 1 minus 1. Okay, makes 135 degrees with the positive real axis, and observe these two lines are perpendicular. These two lines are perpendicular. In the second case, this is the same subspace, but look at Z2. Z2 is not perpendicular. The line passing through 1, 2 is not perpendicular to the line passing through 1, 1. Okay, but then you know that since they are independent, the span of these two vectors must be the entire space. But remember that the angle between these two lines, one passing through 1, 1, the other one passing through 1, 2, are not perpendicular. This is crucial. In the first case, I want to determine E such that E be the matrix. I am using the transformation notation itself to denote the matrix. Let E be the matrix corresponding to the projection of W1 onto W2, and so E is let us say alpha, beta, gamma, delta. E must be a 2x2 matrix. Okay. It's a linear transformation on R2. E is this. To determine E completely, I must use a property that E acts like identity on the range of E W1, and it must act like the zero operator on the perpendicular. Do you agree? Range of E is W. Range of E is W. Null space of E is W perpendicular. Okay, and over range of E, that is, if X belongs to range of E, then Ex equal to X. If X belongs to range of E, then Ex equal to X. So E acts like identity on its range. E acts like identity on W. It acts as a zero operator on W perpendicular. Two conditions, but you will get four equations in four unknowns, alpha, beta, gamma, delta. So we will determine E completely. So let us do that in both the cases. In the second case also, this time we cannot talk about the orthogonal projection. We will just talk about the usual projection. It is called an oblique projection. Oblique projection. So I will determine E in the second case such that E acts like identity on W1, that is Z1, and E acts like 0 on Z2. Then I will compare these two cases. Look at the structure of E. How does E look like? So first, Ex equals X if and only if X belongs to W, that is the range of E, and so I am using this condition W1, right, and Ex equal to 0 if and only if X belongs to W perpendicular, W1 perpendicular, that is W2 in this example. Range of E is one dimensional, W1 is one dimensional and spanned by the vector 1, 1. See, I have not taken an orthonormal basis, that does not matter. Spanned by, W1 is spanned by 1, 1, so E of that vector must be itself. So for one thing, alpha, beta, gamma, delta operating on 1, 1 must be 1, 1. 1, 1 belongs to W1. In fact, that is the only vector in this, only independent vector in W1.
Projection corresponding to the projection of V onto W1.
Yes, yes. V onto, yes, projection of V onto W1, yes. I have this in the back of the mind that this will correspond to W1 comma W2. Yes, it is a projection of V onto W1. Okay, so I have this. So this equation gives rise to two equations. Okay, this matrix equation tells me alpha plus beta equals 1, gamma plus delta equals 1. Okay, two equations in four unknowns. Two more equations will come from the second set of equations, Ex equal to 0. So all the four unknowns can be determined. So look at this, Ex equal to 0 if and only if X belongs to W2. I will take that vector 1 comma minus 1, equate that to 0. Alpha, beta, gamma, delta into 1 comma minus 1, that must be this time the 0 vector. 0, 0, okay. Okay, that gives rise to these two equations, alpha plus beta is 0, gamma, sorry, alpha minus beta is 0, gamma minus delta is 0. So alpha equal to beta equals half, gamma equals delta equals half. Okay, so let me write down E in this case. Are my calculations correct? Okay, let us go to the second case now. In the case when R2 is Z1 direct sum Z2. Remember that there is, I do not know if I have told you this before, there is this terminology associated with perpendicular subspaces. This E is called the projection of V onto W1 along W2. E is the projection of V onto W1 along W2, that is what you calculate, along W2.
E is the projection of V onto W1 along W2. Along, you can look at the geometry. So, okay, what is the geometry? Let's go back to the best approximation problem. Say I have a subspace pass through the origin. This is X, okay. This is my subspace W, and I want the projection of X onto W along W perpendicular. So I must go along perpendicular, that's all. See, this is perpendicular. So I reach W along the perpendicular to W from X. Okay, that's the reason it's called along along W2. In this case, it is the orthogonal projection. But if you look at the case Z1, Z2, the second decomposition, it's not orthogonal projection, but we can still say that E is the linear transformation or the matrix of the linear transformation of R2 onto Z1 along Z2. We can still say along Z2, okay. This time it is not an orthogonal projection. This time it is not an orthogonal projection, okay. So what I have tried to do is I have done the whole thing for orthogonal projections, and I am trying to imitate this for the ordinary oblique projection. I have taken the property of the orthogonal projection and trying to imitate what it satisfies in the non-orthogonal case. What do I expect of a projection in the non-orthogonal case? What do I, so essentially what do I expect? The property of a projection is that, of course, it is E square equal to E, and it is a linear transformation. Okay, apart from that, what are the important properties? Range of E is W1, null space of E is W2. This is essentially what I am trying to imitate in the non-orthogonal, the oblique case. And I am trying to see what is the difference between the matrices that I get. What is the difference between the transformations in these two cases, okay. So let us go to this case when I write R2 in this manner. Again, I will do a similar thing. So I will use these calculations. I want E to act like identity on W1, which is Z1. And Ex equal to 0, this time Z2, okay. Observe Z2 is not perpendicular to Z1, okay. Identity, this equation will remain as it is, okay. Z1 is the same as W1. But the other one will be 1, 2, okay. This is the only change. The other one will be 1, 2. So I get these equations, alpha plus 2 beta equals 0, gamma plus 2 delta equals 0. In the case when R2 equals this, E is given by the matrix. Just to avoid the confusion, I do not want to write 2 E's. So E is given by this matrix. So what is that this time? Can someone make the quick calculation? Alpha is minus 2 beta, beta is minus 1, alpha is 2, is that correct? Beta is minus 1, alpha is 2. The next one I will write without looking at the equations. What is the next one? It is not the same. Is it the same or a minus of that? It is the same, okay. The other, see, this will be a rank 1 matrix. So the second row will be a multiple of the first row. In this case, the same as the first row. This will be a rank 1 matrix. You know why? This will be a rank 1 matrix. This is also a rank 1 matrix. I mean, this is not invertible. This will also not be invertible. Okay, in this case, why is it not invertible? No, no, please, come on. That is not my question. You mean I'll give you a 2x2 matrix, ask you to tell me the determinant? I want a qualitative answer.
E is not, if you restrict the function from E to E, then its function is bijective. So then
E is a linear transformation from R2 to R. What prevents E from being a bijective linear transformation? This is the question. Pardon? Why is it not an injective? Why should it not be? That's the question.
Null space is not
equal to 0, so it is not invertible.
Can we expect E to be invertible? That is the question. Can we expect E to be invertible?
If W equal to V, then this is pi.
Yes, that's the only situation. That's the only situation. Only these are the only two extremes. You expect, so the only injective, see E square equal to E. If E is invertible, what happens? E is identity. The other extreme, E square equal to 0, the other extreme is that E is 0. Now in one case, V is equal to W. So W perpendicular is trivial. In the other case, V equal to singleton 0. So W perpendicular is the entire space V. These are the two extremes. Okay, invertibility cannot happen for a projection. If it happens, it's identity. Identity, there is no problem. The problem is not there in the first place. Okay, so E can never be invertible. Okay, range of E equal to W. So if E is invertible, then W is the whole of V. So W perpendicular is trivial. Okay, so this is my E in the second case. What is the difference between the structures of E? Is there any difference? You can of course verify that E square equal to E in this example as well as in this example. Okay, but what is there a qualitative difference between the structures of E in these two examples? If yes, what is it? Is there something that you can say for the first one which you cannot say for the second one? Structure, looking at the form, E transpose is E, that is essential. E transpose equal to E is in fact another characterization for an orthogonal projection. E transpose not equal to E corresponds to the oblique projection. So E square equal to E, E transpose equal to E and range of E determine E completely. E square equal to E, E transpose equal to E, range of E, that is the subspace range of E must be known to me. These three determine E uniquely in the orthogonal direct sum case. In the oblique direct sum case, I must know range of E, I must know null space of E as well as the fact that E square equal to E. In the oblique projection case, E square is not equal to E, sorry, E transpose is not equal to E. Okay, so remember there is another important thing which I hope you have observed, which is for the subspace W1 there is a unique subspace which together with W1 forms a direct sum decomposition. This unique subspace is unique in the sense that it is perpendicular to W1. Okay, but for the second setup, Z2 is just one complementary subspace of Z1. In place of Z2, I could have taken span 1 comma 3, I could have taken span 1 comma 4. All these are complementary subspaces to Z1. Okay, so in the case of orthogonal projection, there is a unique decomposition of the vector space V into W plus W perpendicular. In the case of ordinary projection, there are infinitely many direct sum decomposition. That is, given a subspace W, there are infinitely many complementary subspaces that those can be obtained by an oblique projection. Those can be obtained by oblique projection. The unique subspace is obtained by the orthogonal projection. Okay, so this is really the essential difference between an orthogonal projection and an oblique projection. Okay, so let's then move on to the next topic. Okay, the topic is linear functionals and adjoints of linear transformations. Linear transformations and adjoints of linear transformations. Linear functionals is what I want to discuss first. Linear functionals and adjoints of linear transformations. The notion of adjoint will generalize the notion of symmetry, the operator, the operation of taking given A, taking the operation A transpose, given A doing the operation A star, that will be generalized in a inner product space. We will call that as the adjoint operation, but before that linear functionals. Okay, so what is a linear functional? Definition. A linear functional definition. Underlying field. Okay, that is a linear functional. Okay. What we will do is first give a representation for linear functionals. Okay, this result is easy. And this also should immediately remind you of a theorem in functional analysis, which you will do a little later. Linear functionals and adjoints. So first, I have the following. Let V be a finite dimensional inner product space. Let V be a finite dimensional inner product space and F be a linear functional on V. So the underlying field is real or complex. So F is a linear transformation from V to R or C. Then the representation theorem says there exists a unique vector y in V. There exists a unique vector y in V such that the operation of this linear functional is like taking inner products with the vector y, such that the action of F on any vector x is given by the inner product x comma y for all x and v for a fixed y. If it is a linear functional, then it arises precisely in this manner. Okay, the proof is just by producing the vector y. Okay, and we will show that y is unique. Okay, but this is called a representation theorem. That is, any linear functional is represented by this inner product. The proof is we start with an orthonormal basis and give the formula for y. Let us say this is u1, u2, etc. un, let B be an orthonormal basis of V. V is assumed to be finite dimensional, so it has an orthonormal, finite orthonormal basis. I know F, I want to find Y, which I must show is unique and satisfies this equation. Define y by y equals summation j equals 1 to n f of uj bar uj. Define y to be this vector. F is known, so I can determine y. look at the images of the basis vectors under F, take the conjugates and then form this particular linear combination. Okay, so we will show that this Y satisfies this equation and show that this Y is unique. Consider for 1 less than or equal to k less than or equal to n the inner product of uk with y. This is inner product uk. Y is this summation j equals 1 to n f u j bar u j. The inner product is conjugate linear with respect to the second one. So when this comes out, it goes with the conjugate, double conjugate, summation f u j into the inner product u k with u j, with j being the running index, k has been fixed. So when j takes a value k, this is 1, all other terms are 0, this is an orthonormal basis. So the only term that remains is when j is equal to k, you substitute here, it is fuk. So we have shown fuk is uk with y, this is an orthonormal basis, so for any x this will be true, because any x there is a linear combination, right? Is that clear? That is, if x belongs to V, then x can be written as summation j equals 1 to n, in fact the coefficients are x uj with uj. And so if you look at fx, then fx is summation j equals 1 to n, f is linear, so it is x uj fuj, but fuj is I want to show fx equals x comma y. Okay, x u j f u j, this is okay, it would have been better to okay, it does not matter. Can I just say this is inner product x with y? You can verify, you could have, we could have started with x with y, start with inner product x with y, then it is x into that formula, f uj goes out and then I must take the inner product of uj with x, so I get this. Okay, so you have this representation for any linear functional f, so there is a unique y, uniqueness we have to show. Suppose there is z in V such that fx equals x comma z, okay, then you can compare these two, it follows that inner product x with z is inner product x with y. This means that okay, this means that inner product x with y minus z equals 0 for all x and v. This means since this is true for all x, I can replace x by y minus z, which means y equal to z. So uniqueness follows immediately. Okay, so every linear functional on a finite dimensional inner product space arises from the inner product with a particular vector. Observe that this y belongs to null space F perpendicular, which is not coming from the proof, but this can be shown. Y belongs to null space of F perpendicular, that is, can you see why this is true? Proof: let x belong to null space of F, I must show that inner product of xy is 0, then fx is 0, that is 0 equals fx, but fx I know is inner product of x with y.
So this means y is perpendicular to null space of F. If x is a random vector from F, then y with x is 0 we have shown. So x belongs to null space of F, V itself is finite dimensional, null space of F is also finite dimensional, so it has an orthogonal complement. So I can write V as null space of F direct sum null space of F perpendicular. Whenever you have a finite dimensional subspace it holds, but V itself is finite dimensional, so this holds. So what this means is that a linear functional on a finite dimensional inner product space is completely determined by its action on null space of F perpendicular. F is completely determined by its action on the subspace null space of F perpendicular. Of course the first term is null space of F, so F takes a value 0 there. F is completely determined by its action on null space of F perpendicular. This is something which does not hold for a general linear transformation. For a linear functional this result is true, okay. Using this representation theorem we will show how the conjugate transpose, it is called the adjoint operator. We will show how the adjoint operator for a linear transformation on a finite dimensional vector space exists and it is unique, and also derive some of its properties, okay, that we will do next time.